It's your returning champion, Elgin Density, aka Scarface Bull Trapone. There's no better way to end Pride Month than to follow up on Jussie Smollett's story. Police body cam footage shows Jussie still wearing the noose that his attackers allegedly put around his neck. It's not unusual for someone like Jussie, who likes taking it backstage, to wear a choker, just not that kind. A surveillance video shows Jussie's hired hangman running away, and a dashboard camera shows them arriving on set. With all this footage and likely more on the way, it seems like these budget Jabberwockies were the only ones who weren't watching their steps. Fortunately, Jussie's acting career has disappeared like corporate rainbow logos in July. Given how much he likes to appeal to emotions to bamboozle everyone, we can only hope he doesn't run for Congress. Enough of these drama queens. On to the first question, which comes from Mike Lupu, who asks, as a gym idiocy connoisseur, what are the top 5 biggest displays of stupidity / sins at the gym? Related to this question, what is worse, curling in the squat rack or curling at the bench press station? I'll answer that question first. Curling in the squat rack is worse because it's harder for anyone to work in. The squatter is going to work with a heavier weight on a higher pin setting, while the curl bro is going to work with a lighter weight on a lower pin setting. By contrast, the difference between the bench bro's pin height and the curl bro's isn't much, and neither is the difference in work weight, so it's easier for them to work in. Now for the top 5. Number 1 is doing CrossFit. Big surprise there, you know what channel you're on. Kipping pull-ups, high rep Olympic lifting, wall balls, taking up multiple stations to do your WOD, it's the undisputed champion of idiocy. It's especially bad at a commercial gym. Like I said several years ago, doing CrossFit in a commercial gym is like doing ballet at an MMA gym. Number 2 would be quarter squatting. I even made one of my shirt labels a quarter squat joke just to remind my customers not to do it. Number 3 would be deadlifting with a rounded lower back, usually with a tapered belt. Gym Idiots as a series has amassed millions of views, yet people still do that. It's one of life's greatest mysteries. Number 4 would be bench spotters who touch the bar while screaming "all you" 7,000 times. Number 5 is people wearing expensive workout clothes and lifting gear just to move poverty weights. Remember in Infinity War when Iron Man threw everything at Thanos just for a drop of blood? That's how you look wearing a slingshot to bench 2 plates. Tim Howard asks, Calf Trapula, what brand of suits is your absolute favorite to wear? Armani, D&G, Prada, etc. First of all, I don't remember handing out top fan badges. Facebook must be doing this on its own. Just use that power responsibly and save some pussy for the rest of us. Well-known fashion houses like the ones you named usually make mediocre suits that people think are top tier because of the brand recognition. You can get a much better suit from a lesser-known brand that doesn't spend much, if anything, on marketing and runway shows. If you're on a really tight budget, consider one of those online suit companies, the ones who have websites in which you input your measurements and then get a suit weeks later. I got some suits from Indochino when I was in law school, and I remember them being adequate. If you have a bigger budget, then get a made-to-measure suit from a company that takes your measurements and makes adjustments on-site. Ring Jacket is one of my favorites. If you've secured some bags and you want the best possible fit, then go bespoke. If you live in a major city, then a tailor will probably visit for a trunk show. You show up to a hotel or brick-and-mortar store that hosts the tailor, choose your fabric, and get measured for your suit. Months later, you return for a trial fitting and to make adjustments. One of my favorite bespoke suits to wear is the first one I ever got from WW Chan. They're based in Hong Kong, but they have trunk shows in DC and a bunch of other cities. Justin Herr, who's named after a money shot, asks, do you actually like the McGriddle or do you just promote it to see how many people you can blimp out? Yes. Any day now, that McDonald's sponsorship offer will be sitting in my inbox. Whatever you do, stick to the Trap Lord style McGriddles with white cheddar and round egg. I tried the triple stack McGriddles, and the only thing I feel besides indigestion is disappointment. The thing that made the original McGriddles so brilliant was how balanced it was. That perfect bite of sweet, salty, savory, fatty, all in harmony. You got that little chewy, doughy, crispy, crunchy goodness all combined into one sandwich. This was just a confused, extravagant mess. You bite into it and it's just soggy, fatty, salty, almost bland in a way. It did not have the same balance as the original McGriddles, and honestly, I'm quite disappointed. Hope that answers your question. Noah on Base asks, what are your thoughts on the URL TV app? and other apps that may require monthly payments to access their content otherwise unavailable on their YouTube channels. URL TV is one of my favorite battle rap leagues, so check it out if you want to know what I watch instead of YouTube Fitness. The URL app lets you watch battles live, score the rounds, and even watch exclusive battles. I imagine URL gets flagged and demonetized a lot due to the rapper's explicit language, so the app makes sense. With YouTube getting more flag happy every year, it's more important than ever to distribute content through other platforms like apps. If your content's really good, then people will give you money to make it. If it's not, then you can always e-beg like DSP. Just kidding, don't do that. Never be like DSP. Sherps asks, do you believe in rep ranges and fixed sets training, like 4 to 5 sets with 6 to 12 reps, or is it always about training to failure? Those aren't the only alternatives. I use RPE for my bench, squat, and deadlift, and I use set and rep targets for my accessory lifts, like rows and face pulls. Always do face pulls. In both cases, I don't go to failure, and in some cases, I add sets and reps if I'm feeling especially good. My coaches and I have given our clients programs with fixed reps and sets, as well as more auto-regulated programs. Don't be afraid to mix those styles of training and then make further changes. If you're hitting regular PRs safely, then you're probably fine. BoyScout244 asks, Traplord, if budget is no matter, what suit, watch, tie, and cufflinks would you buy and why? I don't wear cufflinks, so I know jack about them. I don't like diamonds and other precious stones though, so I don't imagine I'd pick crazy expensive cufflinks if I had to. I'd get a suit and tie made of vicuna, or vicuña, because it's the rarest and most luxurious fabric in all the land. For the watch, I'd get a Patek Philippe 5208P Grand Complication, and for shoes, I would get bespoke John Lobb Black Cap Toe Oxfords. Pen, whatever that says, asks, Mike Chang is back on YouTube. What's your thought on his new videos? Mike Chang hasn't really left YouTube. He's been uploading to his personal channel since 2015. I haven't made a video about him in years because he doesn't really matter anymore, especially without six-pack shortcuts to back him and spread his garbage all over the internet. His channel hasn't even gotten 100,000 subscribers ever since he went solo, which goes to show you how much his brand relies on paid ads. I also haven't watched his new videos, but whatever he's doing can't possibly top his use of the towel row and the sushi fork. As long as he has limited reach, then he's no real threat. He's just a chained-up zombie walking around the cemetery I put all my adversaries in. Mark Crit asks, El Trapo, do you think large companies will soon take advantage of the fat acceptance movement for money like they did to the LGBTQ, you're missing about 700 letters, community during Pride Month? Soon? They already are. For example, Gillette is pandering to them to buy razors, and TV shows and magazines are trying to get their viewership or readership by telling them that they're healthy and beautiful. The talking heads who lead the fat acceptance movement exploit it way more than large companies do. Tess Holliday, large company, if you have her over as a guest, has built a career on encouraging people to stay fat. Everyone in the fat acceptance movement plays the victim, so they don't mind being exploited anyway. Okay, Dick Tarts, it's time for the lawyering round. Let me adjust my glasses of lawyering. Ahmed Zafir asks, Trapzilla, I pose to you a probable lawyering question. Defend all claims against Brittany Dawn that imply her fraudulent tendencies, simultaneously marketing her plant-based supplements and clothing line in a positive way, or locked up in prison with Cali muscle and forced to prepare and chug his hyphy mud pre-workout. I'd pick option one. There's no such thing as a fraudulent claim, so I'd have no claims to defend her against. And I'd promote her supplements and clothing line in an email campaign targeted to prominent fat acceptance activists. They won't buy her clothes because they won't fit, and they won't buy her supplements because they don't work out. Thaddeus Fieldsington asks, McTrappy Meal, I present a lawyering question for your consideration. 1. You have to grow and wear a 6-inch high blonde man bun on your head and wear it, unwashed, for the rest of your life. Or 2. Do a mile-long 3-legged race. The losers of the race would have to give their YouTube subscriber base over to the winners and follow their fitness plans for 10 years. Your partner would be Tess Holliday. Your opponents, Brittany Dawn and Mike Chang, would win, causing you to lose your subscribers. They would win, but for the following master plan. I choose option 2. The only way Tess Holliday will walk a mile is for food, because feeding time puts her in a frenzied state during which she won't notice the distance. Before the race, I'll tell her that a giant cake with her face on it is waiting at the finish line, which will cause her to charge forward. Next, I'll tell Mike Chang and Brittany Dawn that someone from the Federal Trade Commission is also waiting at the finish line, which will cause them to run away. Easy win. Finally, Cash Hadjik, my motherfucker, is back after studying very hard and getting his V-Shred Soma type certification. Wish him luck on his fitness career. Anyway, he asks, "Dear Trap Lord, I present to you a potential lawyering question. You have to non-sarcastically and genuinely promote one of these two things. You can't make fun of either of them or encourage people to do so. You'd have to make a 10-minute monetized video about them every week for the rest of 2019 and give them the ad money. Would you rather promote 1. Kenny Fake O's protocol on how to gain 20 pounds of muscle in a week, or 2. Promote and provide real evidence how Tess Holliday is truly fit and strong. To avoid giving either of them any money, I'll make the monetized videos on a channel that I don't tell anyone about, so I never reach the $100 minimum payout threshold. To waste as little time as possible on these videos whose ad revenue I don't even get to keep, I'll say the same thing on a loop, which is how most people crank out 10-minute videos every week anyway. I choose option 2. I'll promote and provide real evidence on how Tess Holliday is truly fit and strong. That's right, I'm going to make weekly videos about Tess Holliday by summoning my inner every damn day fitness. I won't hurl insults, I'm just going to state facts. I'm going to state the facts that Tess Holliday is strong because she exerts great force on the ground, and until she loses weight, she's fit to leave an even bigger hole in the ground than the one she left in this picture.
Like the video and subscribe to the channel now.
Everybody drugs their body sometime. Everybody tries the gear somehow.